We do have a great program today, and Mara Hoffman is here, and we're glad that you're all here too. Our MC today is Michelle McCormack. She is SVP of Creative at Printed Village. Printed Village connects their global community of artists and designers with some of the world's top retailers. Please let us welcome Michelle.
Good morning. We have an amazing event planned today. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Parsons New School, for having us. Today marks the second in a series of talks entitled The Creative Economy, How Fashion, Business, and Art Intermix, presented by Printed Village. A little bit about us. Printed Village is a global community of designers. Our platform allows anyone to upload their work and participate in themed monthly design challenges. Printed Village is proud to be launching artists like you into the world of retail. So without further ado, let's please welcome Mara Hoffman.
So is it true, what I heard, that you graduated from Parsons and then just started your business?
It is true.
That's amazing.
So as I said, I graduated in 99, and I was kind of at that like uncertain place of what would come next. Throughout, like especially like my junior and senior year of school, I was really actively making pieces. Like I would set these challenges for myself where I'd wake up with enough time, like an hour before I had to leave, and like challenge myself to make the entire outfit.
So ambitious.
But like weirdo pieces of like deconstructed nylons as a shirt, and it was a different time. And I had an overlock machine, a serger, so everything I would just sort of like stitch together, and it was its own kind of art project. But I was making other pieces. Mm-hmm. Oh, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, were you thinking of it at that time as a business? Like, were you making
I
want to sell
student.
This?
No, this is student time. So it was more of like a challenge of
creativity.
How do I express myself?
Yeah.
And sort of in opposition to what I was learning in school, which was very much like based on proper construction, pattern making, like the rules of it. So the stuff that I was doing on my own was very anti-rules of it.
Yeah.
So it was like, I don't even think I used tape measures. It was like scissors. I had an internship and a relationship with an artist designer in school named Elisa Jimenez, who was really influential in teaching me how to sort of like throw everything away and sew with hand by hand with fishing wire and measure the body through how many fists and open palms and
amazing.
Things like that. So I was experimenting with that in contrast to what I was learning on a formal level.
Were you showing your teachers that stuff you
I was
doing
wearing
in the morning?
It. I was kind of living in it.
But you
it.
Weren't like submitting it. Ever.
No, I couldn't really submit it because we still had to like make those marks of how were my sewing skills on a machine, what really like understanding proper pattern making, all of those things.
Did you find peers of other students that were like you that were doing this experimental stuff or to inspire each other?
There were a few weirdos in there,
yeah.
Definitely, that like we were definitely drawn to one another.
Yeah.
I found other peers outside of school, definitely, that were artists and
like older?
Yeah, older, definitely. During this time, I feel like my group of friends, strangely, were this like 12-year cycle older than me. And
of course, yeah.
It's really what helped start what I started doing after school, because I became friends with people that were styling. And at this time in 99, it was really sort of the birth of celebrity in this kind of pop music driven way. It was around, like Khalees came out then, Beyonce was coming out, J-Lo was sort of coming out. In that like late 99, early 2000s, this sort of like rise of these pop stars were happening. And my friends were happening to style these people.
Nice.
And so they would call me to do one-offs. Like, I started batiking and doing hand dyes, and this was all in my apartment on 28th and Lexington, and making these one-of-a-kind kind of art fashion pieces, but very dancer-based, a lot of jerseys. I was a ballet dancer for years, so I was very inspired by movement and things that you could move in. And so they would call me to make these pieces for a music video, and that's sort of like where I really started making these one-offs for stylists.
Okay, and were you thinking at that time, like, I'm gonna be a fashion designer, this is gonna be my business?
I was kind of in this, no, like right at the end of school and in that like senior year, I was still like, I knew I didn't want to take the 7th Avenue route. I was like, I know I don't belong there. I'm not going to go and fight my classmates for a position. At the time, it was like Calvin Klein or Donna Karan and that idea. Right. Like, I'm not, I wouldn't fit in that setting. And sure. I don't.
You didn't want to work for someone
else. I knew there had to be something else, and there had to be like a different way that I could apply what I felt passionate about. And at the very end of that year, I thought, well, maybe I'll go back to school for costume design. Because my senior year, my last project was in costume, and the theme was astrology. And I had a partner who was in school with me, and we made this enormous centaur, like half man horse costume. And like that was my senior, yeah, like here it is. Awesome. Put me out into the world to design clothes for people. Right. And it was like a styrofoam carved like horse's butt on wheels that like the guy dragged around. So
how did you do?
Oh, I won a Golden Thimble Award. I don't know if they still have those here, but at the time there were these awards.
Was it like really technical? Like it was beautifully done?
It's sort of. It was just totally weird and funny. I think that like the humor value, and it was done well enough that like the humor and it,
sure.
it worked. And so, yeah, I didn't know when I graduated from school that I was gonna go and start this business and spend the next like 16 years working for myself. I really didn't know that.
Big changes in those years too.
Huge.
So it must have been a ride so far.
It's been a ride. I had great luck when I graduated. I was continuing to make a ton of pieces and sort of figuring out what would be next. And I had a friend who had a consignment store in Nolita, which was much different then too. And I'd bring pieces to her store and drop them off, and they would sell, and that's how I would make some money. And I ran into Patricia Fields, who, dating back to, you guys are kids, so this is like, it was the first season of Sex and the City. This is a really long time ago, but she styled Sex and the City. And so I ran into her in this friend's store, and she liked, her and her partner at the time, liked what I was wearing. And said, well, what's in the bag? And I had brought, you know, like 10 or 15 pieces in there to try and sell. And she ended up buying the bag from me.
Wow.
She gave me like $250 for like the bag. And I was like, wow. And at the time she had two stores in New York, these kind of club kid, do you remember these stores?
I do, yeah, there was a hair salon in behind
yeah,
one.
Yeah, there was like Hotel
drag
Venus
queens and,
and House of Field,
House
and these
of Field,
were like
yeah.
major...
The Vogers,
yeah,
like the ballroom
this
dancers.
This was like
yeah.
the time of voguing, like club kids, drag queens, like it was real in New York.
That what a break to get her to like
Yeah, and
that.
So she had her buyers call me the next day, and they came over to my little studio apartment where I hand-dyed everything. My tub was dyed purple. It was just like, it was definitely a weirdo artist spot. And I tried on everything I had made for the buyers. They sat on my couch, and I like got undressed, showed them the clothes, and they placed an order. And they placed an order for $5,000, which was like, I called my parents. I'm like, I'm rich. This is it.
Right?
Like, I'm done. Oh, my God.
So Pat Beals was your first retail order?
Yes.
That's interesting. That's really
cool. And I, like, holed up in my apartment, and I handmade that entire order. I had no idea how business ran. As they were saying what they liked and writing an order, I was like, I can have it done by this weekend. Like, give me 5 days.
Yeah,
and they're like, chill. You can have more than 5 days to complete this order. Like, you know, we'll give you a month or whatever it was. And I remember hand-delivering the order in a dyed pillowcase. Like every part of the process was still like this kind of the art of it. And then that was the beginning. And that was that feeling of, oh shit, like I can do this. Like it gave me that confidence. I was super young. And I think when the younger you are too, not that you can't do it at any phase, but the younger you are, it's like when you got nothing to lose. And it really felt like that.
So yeah, for sure.
I took it from there.
Nice. So about being younger, like, so your childhood, did you grow up in an environment where, like, you were encouraged to be this kind of, like, creative, like, do whatever you want, like, creatively experiment type of thing?
Yes, I had a creative upbringing. It wasn't, like total weirdo bohemian lifestyle. There was still structure to it. Yeah. My father is a classical cellist in the Buffalo Philharmonic. I grew up in Buffalo. My mother has always been like a muse-worthy type of inspired human being who definitely neither of them tried to kind of fit me into a hyper-academic box, or they appreciated the creative and pushed for it.
What? Siblings?
I have an older sister. Yeah. She's 4.5 years older.
Okay.
She's in Buffalo.
Nice. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, great. So your childhood sort of like got you ready for this kind of like the
Definitely.
Freedom that
it was,
you saw.
I had a true privilege to have the support to actually consider art and design, which I don't think a lot of people necessarily have. It is a privilege to have that, or to even be encouraged to go in that direction, or like just through the application processes.
Right.
I was supported in that and given that idea that like this is a viable career choice.
So then going from there to like having your own business, and like it's a tough business, like fashion in New York City.
Hustle.
It's a hustle. How did you, were you mentored along the way? Like, how did that happen?
I feel like I've had some awesome mentors that I maybe didn't even know that they were mentors at the time. It's like people, I think I have really great luck of drawing the right people into my life at the right time. Mm-hmm. And I think like I've been a lot of my own mentor in just like my own mistakes, if that makes sense. Like, I tell people that ask me, what do I do when do I graduate? Like, do I start a business? And you kind of have two paths with it. It's like you can learn from other people's falling and standing up and watch that carefully and study it and learn from it. Or you can do it yourself. And they both have definite pros and cons.
Sure.
But I feel like I learned a lot from falling down and like understanding how to stand up. I know that sounds quite kind of cliched, but it's true.
Sure. And so you've recently shifted to sustainability more. So what has that process been like?
It's a big one. It's been an interesting one because I think that it's one thing to start a company with that as your driving force. And I would hyperly encourage any student in here that is like entering the world from here, or if you are currently designing, like that you make those decisions from the get-go. There's like not even a reason to not.
And can you talk about that a little bit? Why is there not? Is it not a lot more difficult to do that? Is that a myth that
changing your company like mid-course,
or even just being a sustainable company? A lot of people think that it's more expensive to be.
I mean, I can speak to my experience with it, and that we had been going for like 14, 15 years, and when within those 14, 15 years, though, the company did not always look like what it looks like right now. Like, as I explained, I started making everything. So when I say, it's 16 years old, it started hand dyeing, hand making one of a kind pieces, and then that evolved to like not being able to lift the dye buckets because I was dyeing all of these pieces, and the actual labor of it was starting to hurt my back, and I was like, ugh, and digging wax with my fingernails and having my mom come, and there were all those parts of the business. And then I discovered that I could draw prints, and that could be an expansion of the narrative, and I could reach a broader market, and I could speak to more people through that, and I could tell a more intricate story through prints than I could with dyes and batik.
Okay.
So that was the first transition. Like, the company's gone through a lot of I've gone through a lot of like evolution and reincarnation.
But you're still a privately held company.
Which is its own trip, to remain independent through it.
For that long, yeah.
Yeah. So that the prints came in 2005. Swimwear was introduced in 2008, which sort of started defining the brand in a lot of ways. And then we got to a few years ago, and the main idea was like waking up every day and making it work and focusing like so closely on the business at hand and making sure that the people that were showing up for me could get paid, that I could like continue to run a business. And that was my focus. Mm. Because when I started this, like the idea of sustainability wasn't even really, it wasn't such an emphasis. Like, I remember learning about hemp fabric early on, and I was so like, oh, wait, this is rad, I can use hemp.
Yeah.
But it was way less of a conversation or something that I felt I had to do in a way. Mm-hmm. And then I just started becoming more and more aware of what was happening in this industry and how damaging it really is, and it really is. And I'm sure you guys are all learning about that in your classes because I know that they talk about that here, which is good. And I got to a place about a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago, and I just felt, what am I doing? Like, I have a son now who's 5, and he was probably like 2.5, and I started having this other awareness of, it isn't just like making and manufacturing all of these things. It's like, well, what happens to these things? Like, what's my kid gonna do with all this stuff that mm-hmm. I've been making? I'm just like making stuff. Right. And so it became something that I kind of couldn't really wrestle with anymore. Mm-hmm. And I went to my director of production, who's also a very close friend and a pillar in my company. I said, what do we do here? Like, it's not just like business as usual. Do we close or do we try and change everything? And she's very pragmatic and grounded and
process.
Capricorn, and yeah. She looked at me and she was like, let's do this, let's just try. Like, let's just try and do this. And that's what we've been doing for the past close to 2 years, is trying a lot and realizing that there is so much that you can do as an established company to change your course. And I think that that's been this has sort of been the most exciting part of doing all of this, is realizing that, like, you can change in the middle of it. And just because, like, you're doing something, you can, it's not just rooted for that one final direction.
Right. I think it's about being, like, committed to a process, right? Like, it's probably, you know, you can't just change it like that and expect.
No.
That would be
painful. You never can. I mean, you all, I'm sure most of you know this, that even if, like, sustainability is your goal, like, you'll never in the industry be 100% sustainable. It's impossible. You don't start a business or close your business, and then you can be closer to sustainable, but as far as manufacturing clothing. So, but it's the becoming an alternative within the industry and becoming a different choice and doing it in your aesthetic and offering things with purpose as opposed to just offering things. And I think that that's like the biggest thing that we have to own now as designers, is taking on that responsibility. Like, there's no more just like going out there to like make things to fulfill just ego. Like, I'm just gonna make things and put my name all over that shit and just push it out there. We can't do that anymore. Like, we just can't. So, right. I don't know.
It seems that you're not being that public about the sustainability.
No, it's new. It's sort of like a quiet,
like, you're not like, what is it called, greenwashing? Like, when people brand themselves that way.
We're still at this really interesting, like, beginning. It'll always be the beginning too with this process, but at a beginning place with it, where the past spring collection that we just put out we made huge strides with it. Like, the shifting in our fabrications is our biggest piece of the effort, and where we were able to make those shifts. And I feel so proud of the spring collection and what we did. Even the resort collection was like getting there. But the spring collection that'll come out in February is really like that, the furthest we've come. And I still, like, it hasn't been the driving force to use it as my marketing tool right now. It's more about like just doing the work and understanding how to do it and like learning how to do it. And I think also things like this become successful when people are still emotionally connected to the clothing on an emotional level, mm-hmm. not because they feel like it's the right thing to buy, but because they look at it and they're like, this is so beautiful. Oh my God, this feels good. This color is beautiful. Oh, I can see myself. Like, all of those emotional connects have to lead. And so I'm still letting those lead, and at the same time making all of those changes to the manufacturing.
It's more like organic. Like, people will find out.
And will be communicated, and we are finding our words with that. But it is like, I don't want to go out there and just scream like sustainability. I'm in this for the long run.
Yeah.
And I feel like it will happen organically.
So do you plan out, like, how far in advance do you plan out your, like, are you like three seasons
right now?
Out?
Like, We're in fall 17, so we finished. We also, you know, we have the swim line, so it's always like another collection mixed in there. So we're done with our sales for spring, and we are about to go into sales for spring swim, and we're in design for fall 17, ready to wear.
Okay. And so I'm sure the audience would be interested in this. What do you look for, Mara, when you're hiring? I'm sure your team is the most important thing.
Yeah, for your business. My team is everything, like all capital letters, everything.
Everything.
We definitely have a specific company culture. The office space itself is an open plan. We have plants growing on the walls. It's like a very non-corporate, very creative environment. And so I think the first thing is the people that are attracted to that kind of environment, and it isn't for everybody. So that's the first step. Like, do you feel that you belong in this? Like, we're also, I think, 28 women and one man.
Really?
And that's it's not like a specific... He is controller.
Okay.
Yeah, but he's been with me. Let me just tell you, which is so awesome. He's like my brother and has been with me since I was dyeing things. And he started because he had a car, and his girlfriend was interning with me when I like ran the company with like two interns and me and one other person. And he would take the laundry in his car to the laundromat, and he'd sit and he'd wait. And then I was like, okay, this works. And then he knew how to use QuickBooks. He knew how to make invoices on the computer. I mean, really grassroots. And
he wasn't a math person.
Like yeah,
at the
I
time?
Mean, he was enough, and he was like, okay, yeah, I can definitely make you not handwritten invoices. So, and I was like, you've got a
That's
job.
That's huge, though, right?
And this was years and years and years ago. And then he grew with the company and grew our operations department. Mm-hmm. Like when we stopped shipping from our little studio and brought on a fulfillment center.
Those pieces are so important for a business.
Yeah, there's so much.
Successful.
There are all these layers and layers to it. And then he said, I'm going to go, and I'm going back to business school, and I want to get an MBA. And it was like, oh, heartbreaking farewell. Oh my God. And so I went back to school, I got an MBA, and now he's back in the company for years. Yeah, I think we were always meant to.
And how great is that to have like loyal employees?
It's great, and I have a few people like that in the company that have like been there a very long part and have seen so much of the evolution.
Right.
Which is such a
How big is your company right now?
28 people, I think we are now.
Okay.
Yeah, but the employees and looking for people. I mean, it's definitely a vibe of, do you fit in here? Like, would you be happy here? And then depending on the department, I think I look for different things. Like, it's sort of a different, like, what am I looking for out of a designer versus somebody maybe in PR? Mm. Or in sales, because our sales are in-house. There's different personalities for these different roles.
And you have your hand in all of it. Like, a lot of people will, like, leave, you know.
I probably drive everybody crazy. Mm. Yeah, I have my hand in it.
No, I'm sure. Like, that's important, I think.
Yeah, they're like, leave me alone.
Exactly. Uh-huh. But it's your business, right? And it is all about culture.
Yeah, it is. Like, and I think also being independently run, like, it's been so hands-on. I mean, this is like my kid, my other kid. This is my first kid.
Exactly, yeah. Right. So do you bring him in? Does he come in?
He comes in sometimes, but he's a maniac. He's five. I don't know if any of you are familiar with five-year-old boys.
They're awesome.
So he like runs laps through like the office screaming and like loves the attention. And
nice.
He really likes ladies. So he's into all the ladies
around. Oh, it's perfect.
Yeah.
Mommy, can I go to work with you?
Yeah, he's good.
So what do you do, Mara, if you ever, I mean, maybe it doesn't happen to you, do you ever, like, lose inspiration? I'm sure, like, these guys would love to hear, like...
The creative process?
Yeah, like, that thing that happens.
You know, this industry, I'm sure, like, you'll know this, it really, it pushes it out of you as a creative, and if you're a true creative or an artist, it's really challenging. I'm married to an artist who, we talk about this a lot, he can take years on one concept. He can take like 3 years putting together one show. He can take longer than that, you know, and then the next show can look just like that other show, you know, because it's just this continuation in this process that he has this great luxury and privilege of being in as a creator. And in our industry, it's not like that.
Do you wish you had that? Or do you
love the way it is? At times I do, because I have both feelings. Like at times I'm like, oh, wouldn't that be amazing if I could just, like, give it the thought that it really, truly needs? If I could, like, like just work out those ideas more. Like, mm-hmm. I know it could be better, but we don't have that. Like, things have to go. We have to put that work out. So too fast, honestly, and I think that's a big conversation in our industry, is like how fast we're pushed to push things out, and like why designers burn out, and why there's this sense of we get to these places where there isn't such originality at times, because to keep up with this demand on a creative level, it's really tough. But the other flip side of me thrives in that kind of fire and thrives in that sort of short attention span. Aries, no, but it's that feeling of, okay, get it done, go fast, okay, next, go fast, and next.
Right.
And so
that space is hard to live
in.
I'm used to that run.
Yeah. Now I'm like used to that like sprinting kind of thing and not a long stride. It's like all these sprints. It's not enough. Yeah, I think that we should take, it would be awesome if we could put less collections out and really take more time and make more purposeful things. It comes back to that same concept of like, how purposeful is the work that we're doing? Mm-hmm. And it would be beautiful to have more time.
So you've been in business at least 16 years now, mm-hmm. So it's actually gotten worse, right? I would say with social media and the internet, like how do you reconcile that at this point?
The speed of it?
All of it, yeah. Like, just even,
I have definitely, like, a real love-hate relationship with social media. Like, my own, what I run in my, I run the Instagram account, and I have since the beginning, and
Because it's important to.
I've had deep passion around it a couple of years ago, where I was like, this is amazing, oh my God, I can, like, communicate to all these people, And now I've been in this really big internal shift around aesthetic, not only just like the sustainability portion of it, but just like creative, like aesthetic as far as what I want to put out into the world. And I'm at this funny place, it's not funny, it's actually super real, where like I don't even want to see anything that I've made in the past few years. I'm like, it's all haunting me. Like I don't relate to it, and I want to hit refresh and be able to just like create right now what feels really sincere to now, and it's really different from what it's been feeling like. And then enter Google, and you can never get away from like your entire history as a designer and artist now. And I think back in years ago, it was kind of cool because you could sort of reinvent yourself and not have to be continually reminded about like everything that you've done up until that point as a creative.
There's two like that would be kind of bad too, because then you're only as good as your last thing. To some people who don't know who you are.
Yeah,
before
it's like
the
internet. If you throw in my name, it's like, I don't feel like any of that right now. Like, that's not who I am. That's not what I'm trying to make. And so also, it's like an interesting thing when you run a business and you try, as a creative, you're running a business, so you're a creative director and making sure that everyone's getting paid and that stores are still picking up your line, but your vision changes. And that's what I'm going through right now.
And in communicating that to your team, your creative team, that must
be challenging. Luckily, I'm really surrounded by such like fluid, like true creators that can kind of go with that, and they've been evolving too. So it isn't about saying to a creative team, I know you really love like doing hyper geometric, bohemian things, but we're going to shift now.
Right.
It isn't.
It's
everyone's sort of part of like feeling this like collective consciousness that's happening within the company and what's happening with me, and people vibe off of me in the company.
And that's why you have to have relationships with your creative team, right?
I mean,
like
deep.
It can't just
it's
like,
deep, like
show up for work.
No, no, no.
Right.
And, like,
you're not surprised when it's happening.
No, it's like intimate and communicating this vision. And it hasn't been easy, because a lot of times for me, like, I feel things, and I can see them internally way before I can verbalize them.
Yeah.
And so, but you also have to make sure that you're making commercially driven things, because it's still a commercially driven business, and you still want to support all the people that are showing up for you every day, so you can't just totally artist out and be like, I'm going to take 2 years right now and really just think about this. I wouldn't do that.
But you must have somebody between you and all of that, too. Do you? That helps with...
I mean, I have, like, my pillars that trust me. And I think that that's been such an amazing thing, is to have people that, even if you can't like say what it is I'm trying to like shift to, they trust me that I've done it and I've reincarnated myself a few times in this. Like, from the dies to the prints, like there's been deaths and rebirths throughout this, and the ones that don't trust it, peace out. And then you say thank you for leaving. You should really thank those people that leave you along the way, because they're like stepping out of the way a little bit for you to continue doing what you need to do, and leaving room for the people that will support you to come in. And then I have immense gratitude when I look at this team that like looks at me and they're like, we trust you. We're going with you.
Great.
Yeah, it's an emotional, cool thing.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And then just a couple of more things. What about e-commerce? Like, how important?
Thank God for e-commerce. For us, definitely, yeah.
Can you talk about that for
sure.
these guys?
Let's see. I can say for especially like in transition, it's such a great thing to have, because you can also have this. We don't have any brick and mortar stores, not yet. But our e-commerce has really like grown as far as the proportion of our sales now. And it's a direct outlet to your customer, and you can try things with her, and you can communicate more one-on-one with your customer, which is great.
Your own site or other people's site?
It's my own. I mean, I'm speaking to our own site that we've built. And right now it serves as our store.
Sure.
And it definitely has its challenges, but it's so important.
How do you drive traffic there?
Well, there's different ways, but we work with like a digital agency too that helps as far as like your pay-per-clicks
and
different
Facebook ads and stuff like that.
Yeah, things like that, which on an aesthetic level, like I find it all like, ugh, I don't want to be followed by somebody's or a dress that I, you know, looked at, and I feel like it's really stalkery and weird, but it works and sort of part of that.
It's the way it is, commerce now. Right, to compete.
Yeah, definitely.
And as a business, it's really helpful, and it's only going to get more.
Absolutely. And obviously, you have like a way better overhead with that, and you have a better profit margin. So it really helps supplement. You know, especially going through a transition like this, where I want to shift some of my accounts, and sort of with that aesthetic change comes like repositioning where the brand is. But to have this support and the constant flow of the e-commerce kind of gives you a little bit more grace in what happens in your wholesale business.
And then just to play devil's advocate, on the other side, like now you can actually reach people that would have never heard of possibly Mara Hoffman.
Totally.
Who, like hyper-targeting on Facebook. You can get, you know, people in somewhere in the Midwest that likes stuff like you might like, and your aesthetic, and then they all of a sudden know who you are.
So I'm naked.
Or globally. Which is exciting.
Yeah. It's like part of this like big social media communication with one another. It's like it's gotten twisted, I think, but
sure. People use it good or bad, like the
internet. And I think that like on a lot of levels it's just like driven this, I don't know how many of you like go through an Instagram frenzy and like spend 20 minutes like deep into it and then feel really awesome after. Like, does anybody?
I was like, no.
But I mean, that's the thing. Does it like really instill this feeling of, oh, cool, like, oh, I feel great about myself right now? I mean, the reality is that I think that it like drives this feeling of more insecurities, more like non-connect.
Yeah.
As opposed to like what maybe the intention of it was is to feel connect. What we all really want is just to connect.
Right.
But this, it's become a bit of a beast in that like non-connect place.
Right.
And I feel wanting and I feel not adequate, or I don't have that.
Yeah.
So like
yeah.
I'm not taking that trip. I don't look like that. All that stuff.
All that.
And so like that to me is a bit of the negative that I kind of battle with right now of that relationship to it and the real versus the unreal. But for business and it's great. You can draw more people to buy your things.
So is there a brick and mortar in the future?
I hope so. I think it would be really great.
Totally.
And like, again, being an independent company, like every move that you make is hyperly thought out, planned out. I like being an independently run company, but you don't have like that luxury of being like, I need $1 million to like open this sixth store in New York and then LA, you know, in a month.
Right.
Like everything is more like, okay, well, we're gonna get there, we're gonna do it.
Exactly, very cool. Can we open it up for some questions?
Totally.
Okay. So does anyone wanna come down and ask Mara if you can, come on down. There's on either side, there are microphones set up.
I was wondering if you can talk, there's not a lot of companies that are totally independently run and haven't taken on investment that have gotten to your scale. So I was just wondering if you could talk about the steps, like just how you sort of like funded all of this and how you, at what point you brought in different people and at what point the team really grew to the size it is now, like just sort of the trajectory of it.
Like there's been so much scrappiness through this, like probably uncomfy levels of scrappiness through the process, and I have definitely relied on lines of credit and loans. I have not just like had an influx of cash through this by any means. So there are a few ways to it. I mean, you can take on a factor, which definitely helps in the beginning, and then I don't know if you're familiar with that, if you're in business parts of your education, but where you can kind of borrow against like a purchase order that you have. So say Barney's writes you an order for $20,000, you can borrow from your factor when you show them that purchase order. So there was a lot of that going on. Now at this point, the goal is to sort of like separate yourself from that because you pay interest on those things. Lines of credit, which have been huge for us, but there have definitely been those moments that have been I need $30,000 by the end of this week. Oh my God. But we've found these ways and we've been able to like do it very clean. The steps. I think that the first step was a small SBA loan, like a small business loan that I was able to get. And then a factor that helped. And then larger lines of credit. And then the business was growing and getting healthier and coming into like more accessible cash. But it's only been in the past few years that I feel less of that feeling with it. And we still go through months that we're not shipping as much or we're heavily into production. And so all of the money is going to pay our vendors. And then, so we pull back, and it's also, it's like I compare it to surfing a lot, like the whole thing. It's like, sometimes you're on your belly, and you're just like using your arms, and it's hard, and you're swimming out there, and then sometimes, you know, you see the right wave, and you stand, and it's balance. And then you knock off of it, and you do it again, it's a lot of that. And then you go through ebbs and flows. It's like, you have these great, we've had amazing years a few years past when like everything we were doing was kind of hitting and people were super into it and so the company was growing so fast and we needed to put more people in and then like that shifts and that changes and then as running this business you have that pressure of okay, I just like built up a company to support this thing that was like really working but now it's kind of peaked. And it's changing a little, and I'm changing a little bit, and I don't want to have to just keep offering the same thing until it's dead. Like, I want to get out of it before it's dead, and I don't know if that answered.
Yeah.
It's challenging.
Yeah.
There's ways to do it. There's ways to do it. And you just have to be so scrappy, and I think not make the mistake of when you are doing well to be, like, a baller and, like, get yourself some, you know what I mean? You have to just be... When you grow it so like splitting pennies, it instills this sense of like you continue to split pennies forever with it, and I think that that's what is like leads to a different outcome than making money and being like let's spend it. Yeah,
I think that's like life, isn't it? Like it's not always great, it's not always
no,
bad.
You have to like be prepared for it to like level out or go under
and
a little.
When it's down, you know it's
yeah, it's never going to be always up here.
Yeah.
Never.
Thanks.
Hi, Mara. Thank you. I just had a question, a little bit more so, on like the diversity side. I know that you've been vocal about using black models like Nicor and like getting your inspiration from places like Morocco. But I just wanted to know like what diversity means to you and like how if that has affected your business in any way.
Interesting, good question. Thanks. I feel like before it was a conversation, it was just like a very sincere relationship and inspiration way before this conversation existed. Like, unfortunately, we can't Google back to like when I did start this and like who were the muses of this company, but they have always been a very like diverse, this word now, but diverse set of women. Like, it's just been the heart of what the inspiration is. My first shows with the dyed pieces were drum circles, and they were just incredibly like earthy and primal and inspired by a range of women. And I think that that's just always been what has inspired me, and then the conversation became a lot more relevant and everyone started having the conversation. So it wasn't anything that we were like, okay, it's time to be to cast diversely now, so let's look for women that fit that bill. It's just never been like that. Like, before Nicore, there have been it's always been a driving force of inspiration and not something that was like decided on, and continues to be that, and even more so now. I'm glad it's a conversation. It should have been a conversation a long time ago. It took fashion a really long time to start having that conversation. It took a lot of us as designers a long time to just like wake up and understand that it is not just white and skinny, that there is a lot more, So I think it's just like a forever piece of my inspiration and motive.
Thank you.
I hope that answered it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Mike. I'm a journalist for a publication called Upstart City. I want to ask, so you mentioned that your company has gone through a lot of kind of changes and evolutions. What triggered these evolutions? Like, what made you stop and think, hey, wait a minute, my company needs to change, my direction needs to change? Can you talk about that?
Sure. I think that they've all been rooted in gut for me. Like, it's just, it hasn't, again, been like a really like thoughtful decision process of deciding whether or not I needed to change. Like, things sort of hit me really hard and then they just don't go away, and they're that feeling of I don't want to do this anymore the way I'm doing it. And I've always sort of had this way with it where it'll be processing a little bit, like things will start to feel uncomfortable the way that they're running, or the way that we're messaging, or the way that the prints are looking, or whatever part of it, and I start like sort of disconnecting from it a little bit and feeling, well, I don't totally, it's not so me, it's not so, and then all of a sudden it's like, I can't do it anymore, done, we have to change. So the evolution has, I can like speak from the place of the artist with it, where it kind of rules me more than like me ruling it, if that makes sense. But then with those feelings, I've got to, again, take care of a business to make sure that I don't just act totally impulsively and mess things up. Hi.
Hello. So I've been doing a lot of research on sustainability in fashion, and a lot of designers are saying that the demand for sustainability has to come from the consumers, but a lot of consumers are completely uninformed about these issues. So where do you think the responsibility lies, and what do you think will push the industry to really actually change?
I think that there's responsibility on both sides. So it's ours as the designers, makers, manufacturers, and then it's also the responsibility of the consumers to sort of, at this point, first and foremost, shift habits as far as like how we consume and what is the mentality around that. I think that fast fashion has really like messed our brains up as far as like how we ingest and how we like have to have all this stuff, and it's so accessible and we can buy so much more of it, and it's gotten so out of hand. And I feel like with that, just the value system around things, any kind of thing, has become completely skewed, where the idea that you can get something for so cheap is a driving, like I had heard this quote, which was so great. It was at panel of a few women in working on sustainable efforts, and she said that it was, I can't afford cheap things. And it made so much sense, and that they don't last. And so it's like you can buy all of these things and you can continue to buy them, but they don't last, and then they just become landfill. So it's sort of beginning to shift where I think shifting the consumer to think of what it feels like to spend a little bit more and starting to like feel comfy in that space, but buy less. Like invest in a beautiful piece that's gonna last you for a lot longer. I grew up, I'm sure a lot of you and your parents weren't just like crazily shopping and buying bags and bags and bags of clothes. Like I don't know, maybe some of them, but like I grew up watching my mom like buy like one beautiful piece. And I have some of those pieces now, and this is like 25 years later, like, and the way that she would care for that one piece and what it meant to be ambitious about things that were a little bit out of her reach. Like, this is gonna cost this, but okay, I'm gonna do it, and I'm gonna love this, and I'm gonna wear it in all these different ways. And I think it's like trying to reshift that conversation right now of how do we purchase things, and like, are we doing it with thought or without thought, and starting to get comfier with investing in quality and investing in things that you can wear over and over. And I think it's our responsibility as designers to make those pieces, and we have those conversations internally a lot, like, okay, we can use sustainable and like less harmful fabrics, but we also really have to be better designers and make things that will sincerely last longer and that are designed smarter, and that there's a responsibility on both ends.
Okay. How will anyone be able to do that with the Zaras and the H&Ms?
I don't know. It's a challenging one. I think it goes back to this like social media stuff. It's like, who are you following? Who are influencers? Mm. Like, are influencers people that go to a fashion show and change their outfit 7 times? Like, is that who's influencing us? Or it's like, who are we choosing to be inspirations to us? And I think it's like shifting where we put the emphasis and focus on that level.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, more in business-related area, I would like to ask you, when or in what point do you see that your business had profit? In which stage?
It took a while, I'm sorry to say. It went through different times of it, and I think in the past few years, honestly, it took me a while. If we say that like the company sort of started its like DNA to like what it looks like now in 2005, that would give us 11 years into this. I didn't know what I was doing for a lot of that time. Even like my pricing systems were a little bit, they were based on like, how much would I want to pay for this? And I kind of skipped a lot of those steps that I would suggest.
What is that? Like, so what is it now?
Well, now, I mean, it's like really thought out, like down to every, obviously as it should be, things getting priced and figured out the way that they should be by a team that knows what they're doing, and figuring out every single bit of that cost that goes into making the pieces, and then finding a healthy profit within that, profit margin within that. But it took a while to get to that place, probably out of my own inexperience in running a company. And I would highly recommend like taking those business classes and learning how to do that for yourself. I sort of just like winged it, and thank God it worked, but I wouldn't suggest it. And then most recently, like, we've figured out our formulas. So I feel like we've found how to make a profitable, and some years are way better than others. And it depends on your growth, and it depends on where you need to spend money. If it's like growing your team, or you've grown out of your space, and the new space is going to cost so much more. You want to expand on a PR level for something, or are you doing shows or not doing shows? So every year is sort of a different ball game depending on your needs as a company. But it took a while.
Hi, thank you for the speech. And
I have a question regarding like your process to becoming like a more sustainable brand, because it is true that the consumers sometimes just don't want to buy sustainable fashion because the look is different, the fabrics are different, and some designers say that they just don't want to make the switch because they have to give up on a lot of things, and usually like the designs and what the consumer wants. So my question was like, how was your process? What did you do? Do you feel like you had to give up on something, or how do you do to make your designs like more sustainable and still look like appealing for the consumer? Because I think it's really hard.
Yeah. I kind of like touched on it a bit before that, like, in order for this to be successful for me and any of us that want to do this, we have to still be really good designers, and we have to pay attention to that emotional connect still. You can't let that go. So I still have to design things that are going to feel really beautiful and that you are going to be drawn to on an aesthetic level first. Like, that has to live for it to work out. If you substitute aesthetic and the beauty part of it, or whatever defines your company, if it's not beauty, whatever, the edgy, or I don't know, with just the sustainable factor, it's you're going to lose your customer. So for us, it was, how do we replace the fabrics we're using, but with fabrics that are going to feel even better than the fabrics we were using before? Because it isn't just like staying status quo. It's like, how do I draw her in even more? Like, how does this feel better? Like, how is it softer? How is like the fabric even more of an emotional draw now? How is the design that? Like, how are the shapes even better? So I think it's challenging yourself to keep aesthetic right there with you as you're designing, and then find things that are even better. And there are so many resources, like, you can do it, and the technology now is, it's not an excuse, like, there aren't nice enough fabrics out there, because there really are. There's really beautiful alternatives that you can use, so I think that that, like, argument shouldn't exist anymore. There's, anybody could, like, start changing out even a few things within it, like, even with their cottons, like, shifting into organic cottons, and there's ways to, like, make little shifts.
We have time for one more.
Hi, big fan. I just wanted to ask, like, how long did this shift into sustainability take? Just in terms of like years or months or emotional effort?
Well, we're still in it, and I will probably be in it until I close my business. So always, it never gets totally figured out. So far I've been in the process, it'll be 2 years in January, of like really trying to change things. So as far as I've come to this point, it's been 2 years. What I want to continue to do and shift and change and find more alternatives and less harmful ways, and that's just going to continue to go on and on and on. I don't know where, like, I don't think that there's like an end goal with this.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, I think that's all we have time for.
Thanks for coming, guys.
Thanks, Mara Hoffman.
Oh, and vote. I know, like, it's so crazy, but please just go and vote. Thanks.